across the decades and into a new millennium, the grand old fight song of Ursuline High School bugles its challenge to every Irish opponent and rallies the spirit of every Irish fan. Up in the sky, the lyrics proclaim, there'll be a great big thunder, sounding out our battle cry. The proud tradition of Ursuline Green and Gold has been a huge part of high school football's claim on the hearts of the Mahoning Valley for 68 years. And to the immense satisfaction of Ursuline's many alumni and friends, those storied years have seen our march against the foe down to the other goal, completed with numerous conference championships and state playoff appearances. But the Ursuline legacy of gridiron excellence, rich as it is, offers no precedence for the accomplishments of the team of 2000. Against the best in the tough Steel Valley Conference and a stellar field waiting along a brutal 5-week state tournament schedule in Division IV, the Ursuline Irish proved to be peerless, amassing the greatest season in school history and earning the right to be called a team for the ages.
We as a staff believed with the kids that the amount of talent that we had coming back on both sides of the ball and the amount of experience that, you know, we had a chance to be a very good football team if they came together. I've been at some good programs, but the seven that we had coming back were as good, if not better, than any I've ever had or been around. They were led, of course, by our four down linemen, Ryan Pegues, Brandon Dotson, our two defensive ends, Marcus Johnson and Brandon Brown. And then we had an outstanding group of linebackers, of course led by our seniors, Steve Stroney, Ross Kolar, Brad Hockendonner, and then junior John Angelo. We believe that front seven, as it came to play out, proved itself that they could stop the run and make a team one-dimensional, which, you know, they did. And anytime you could make a team throw the ball exclusively, I think that definitely benefited us as we went down our schedule and even into the playoffs. I thought our skilled positions were a lot better than they had been the previous year. The development of Terrence Graves, his freshman year, could only benefit him going into a sophomore season. And of course we had Justin Adams back, and then Lewis Irizarry at tight end. We had some great skill positions, but the entire offense would be led by our quarterback, Josh Swagger, who gained great experience as a junior and really became a field general, a leader, as the season progressed.
I think the biggest strength we had going into this season was just the tightness of the team. We were always together in the off season.
I'd say the biggest strengths obviously were the skill level. Obviously we had a lot of talent, but we all came together pretty much early in the season as a family, and knowing that we always had somebody to count on was our biggest strength.
The harder they must fall.
Depends on you.
Well, I think we use the Sharon game as a measuring stick for our season. And even before we played that game, we realized that they were a great football team. And going down there was going to be a chore.
Well, my big memories of the Sharon game were it was a hard battle within the heat and everything. I think our defense and our offensive lines really wore them down, and I think they weren't ready for us. I think they were looking on to week two, and they thought they were gonna roll in here and beat us like they did last year. It was a power left play that I bounced out. Really, all the defenders really pushed us in, and once I got around the corner, all I saw was daylight, and I just raced to the end zone.
That game was our, coming home on the bus. You can remember, we really thought that we had something special. Now, we didn't want to tell the kids that, but they thought that. Going into the season, we probably thought that Boardman had probably the best team coming back with the amount of returning starters they had and their experience in the playoffs. Also, I recognized that Coach McDaniels would do a great job at Warren Harding, as he has, at Canton McKinley and wherever he has been. And you also got to recognize the great tradition that Cardinal Mooney has, as well as, I forgot about Carl at Fitch. There was three coaching changes. And Fitch, as the season went on, got better and better, and we knew that they would be a better football team. The Still Valley Conference is a great, great conference. We felt in order for us to win it, we'd had to get off to a great start, and we had to beat, Warren Harding, which was our fourth game but our first league game. When it was 12-7, probably the key to our entire entire season was that goal line stand. Being able to hold them out from the 3-yard line with four cracks, and the type of running team that they had, our defense really stood up to that challenge. And, that took us to places where, being not only 1-0 in the league, but I think the kids started to realize that they had a really special football team. And after that stop, we were able, of course, to get Justin loose on a long touchdown run and able to secure that victory. Anytime you win a Steel Valley game, it's something that you can be thankful for, because they're all good football teams. I've been a part of some rivalries as a coach, but never one as intense as the Ursuline Mooney game. Both communities are really excited about the game, the entire student body, the spirit week that goes on, I believe, at both schools. Everything's at a fever pitch. Being able to come out on top this year, especially after losing our quarterback in the second quarter, and still being able to pretty much dictate to them the type of game that we wanted to play, was an important factor, and it felt very good for the entire staff, players, and of course the entire community. And the offensive line really controlled Mooney's front. We were able to run the ball very well. I think T had over 140 yards, I believe. And we were able to pretty much physically control both the offensive line of scrimmage, and then when we were on defense, the defensive line of scrimmage.
Hand off Grange, breaks the left side, 25-20, he's going to go the distance. He's in the end zone just that fast.
I think the Fitch game made us all rethink some of our positions. I don't know that we were working maybe as hard as we should have been. That includes coaches and players. I think any time you're 6-0 and people are telling you how good you are, you can become complacent. And I could definitely, I sensed the complacency prior to the Mooney game. But, a rivalry game kind of disposes of all that, and you play with that emotion because who you're playing. Our kids were able to refocus as a result of the loss, and I would definitely say that loss helped us more than any win we had all season. All year, our kids, after halftime, were a better team. They became more focused, and they, because they wanted to win so badly, and they, especially in the Boardman game, they knew that it was all on the line, the Steel Valley Championship, bragging rights, because, you know, we like to beat Steel Valley teams. I was never really concerned, though, with the outcome of the game because the way we were able to move the ball. And I thought that we addressed our mistakes and the things that they were doing at halftime, and we came out in the second half and played a great half.
He's on first down, handoff, Justin Adams, who just returned the kickoff, skips his way outside left, heads down the sideline, 30, 20, 10, 5, touchdown, just like that. Didn't give him a rest after the kickoff return. He decided to take it to the house on his second touch.
For 28 minutes, it was like a heavyweight battle. They were hitting us, and we were hitting them back, and fortunately, we were standing at the end of the game. In the playoffs, there's a more sense of urgency because it's sudden death. If you lose, you're done. In the regular season, you can afford maybe a loss or two and still qualify. But once you get in, you know you got to play your best, because if you lose, you know you put your equipment away. And that urgency is something that we carried with ourselves throughout the playoffs, and something that we used as a motivating factor. We didn't want to put our equipment away ever. I think the Aurora game, we started out sluggish because being a head coach the first time in the playoffs, and a lot of kids playing the first time, as starters anyway, in the playoffs, it kind of took us a while to get our feet wet. And then once we got settled down, I think the key of the game was when Robbie Smoltz blocked the field goal and Steven Stroney picked it up and went 78, 80 yards for a touchdown. That really turned the momentum.
I was lucky because Robbie came off the right side, blocked it cleanly. As I picked it up, I saw him hit another guy, excellent block, and I was able to go down the length of the field untouched.
To try a 23-yard field goal out of the hold of Mike Flick, the kick is down and it is blocked, and it's picked up. That's a live football. Ursuline's off to the races. Number 12, Steven Stroney, is going to take it back the distance. 88 yards for the Ursuline touchdown.
After that, we were able to settle in, and Jimmy Riley and Josh Swagger had a terrific game. I think Jimmy had three or four touchdown catches. And Josh had a real good game making decisions, throwing the ball really well. And with that game, Terrence kind of established himself as somebody who was going to be hard to stop in the playoffs. He rushed for over 100 yards.
And the ball game is over. The final score, Youngstown Ursuline 40, the Aurora Greenmen 7.
As we looked at our region going into the playoffs, we figured, you know, Akron-Manchester would be the team that would give us the most trouble. And as it proved that they did in the playoffs. The key probably to the game was early in the fourth quarter, it was still 17-14, and Jimmy Riley and Josh hooked up on, I believe, a 40-some yard touchdown pass.
We switched it up and we called it 285, which would be Jimmy running the post and Adam running the out. And Jimmy ran the post, I dropped back, I seen Jimmy wide open, I just hit him and made the connection again.
And that kind of took the wind out of their sails, because their offense wasn't one that could come back from a 10-point deficit, we didn't think. And, you know, fortunately that proved to be the case. First half we played at Perry was probably the worst half we played. As far as the effort was good, but as far as the mistakes, we had a third and forever, it seemed, and we had so many penalties, blown assignments defensively in the secondary that we didn't do the entire year, and they were concerning to the entire staff and to the players. And I think the field conditions, though, had a little bit to do with how well we were playing in the first half. Perry played on the same field, so, you know, we couldn't use that as an excuse. Going into halftime, you know, we got it. We got after them a little bit, and the kids responded well. we really rotated Delbert and Terrence every other play. So by the in the second half, especially the third and fourth quarters, they were fresh. I think any time you can have fresh running backs against a defense who had, I believe, seven or eight guys going two ways, we were able to eat up the clock and, of course, control the game. And that proved to be something that we would definitely use in our final two games of the season, which helped us win the state championship. The Licking Valley game was one of the most frustrating, the first half of that game, I should say, was one of the most frustrating games I've ever been associated with, because we physically outmatched them and were dominating them. We had close to 300 yards at halftime. I believe they had 100. We were doing anything we wanted. We were running the ball really well. We were throwing the ball well. Josh threw had some key throws, but then we were letting them back in the game with our special teams. They returned three kicks, not all the way, but close enough to put them into great field position and allowed them to score. Fortunately, Josh was able to find Lewis in some seams in the second quarter there. Lewis scored on a boot play down at the goal line where he made an acrobatic catch for a touchdown.
Swagger rolls right, looking for Irizarry in the end zone, has it, juggles it, and catches it.
But he's definitely a weapon that we needed to reestablish.
Touchdown, Irish.
We knew in order to win a state championship, we had to get by the semifinal, and we were there, I believe, twice before, prior to that, and weren't able to get there. And that was a goal of ours, of course, was to get to the state championship game. And, you know, Licking Valley stood in our way, and I think the kids did a tremendous job of executing. Anytime you lose a kid or a football player the caliber of Justin Adams, you feel for him. And not being able to play in this ultimate game was really, I don't know who felt worse, me or him or his family. But we were able to use Justin as a coach all week, and we were able to use, you know, his misfortune and adversity as a motivating factor. And, you know, I made sure our kids before the game realized that.
Sell yourself for one person, and that's Justin Adams. You give your life for him today. You lay it on that field.
In the Coldwater game, state championship game, our offensive line exceeded anything that any expectations I had. I believe they all blocked it over 90% or graded out at 90%. We really took the game to them up front. Anytime you rush for 500 yards and 50 carries, averaging 10 yards a carry, you know, that's almost unheard of, especially when you're in the state championship game where you're playing another great football team, which Coldwater was. John Bartos, Hugh Frost, Rob Smaltz, Tommy Manning, and Ross Kolar, and Louis Irizarry, as well as our fullbacks, Brandon Brown, Brad Hockendonner, and John Angelo, did a terrific job. I can't, you know, tell you how great a job they did at blocking. You know, an offense is only as good as we were up front, and fortunately for us, you know, we were peaking at the right time.
On second down, Swagger, left side handoff, Ferguson, nice hole, 35, look out, 30, into the secondary, 20, 10, 5, touchdown!
They were really playing their best football, you know, at the right time, and, you know, we knew we'd have to play one of our best games, if not our best, in order to win.
Swagger long count, takes the handoff, right side, big hole Ferguson, 35, first down, 40, look out, midfield, down the sideline, 40, 35, 30, 25, 20, he stays in bounds, he's going to score, touchdown, Delbert Ferguson, they couldn't get him out of bounds at the 20, and he went 68 yards for maybe the backbreaker. Quarterback sneak, I don't think he got in. Referees come flying in. He didn't get in. He did not get in on the quarterback sneak, and that should be the roll of these.
First team for your school to ever win the state championship.
It's going to be bittersweet because you develop such a close bond that you don't want to see it end, but I'm glad they went out on top because they deserve it.
Never thought I'd be here where I'm at right now. It's unbelievable.
Time. The story of the state football champions of the year 2000 will be recounted as something truly great and wonderful. Redeeming the promise of an Irish tradition, which has often held out hope for reaching the summit of excellence, which has strived mightily for many years to stand among the best competing in Ohio high school football. And so the Ursuline community celebrates its greatest football victory. And behind the crown and the ring, honors the players and coaches who have comprised its greatest team. For an unselfish, dedicated, talented group in the richly symbolic year of 2000 have managed to leave behind not just their epic record, but an inspiration, not only an accomplishment, but a standard. What they have done as Ursuline's first football state champions can never be duplicated, but its glory may be extended by those of Ursuline yet to come, who find a similar unity. The same kind of heart.
Slip in, and if I fall, I'll never faint. I just get up and try again. Never lose hope, never lose faith. There's much too much at stake. Upon myself I must depend. I'm not looking for place to show I'm gonna win. No stopping now, there's still a ways to go. Some way, somehow, whatever it takes, I know I'll never quit, no, no. I'll never go down. I'll make sure they remember my name 100 years from now. I'll never give up, never give in, never let a ray of doubt slip in. And if I fall, I'll never fail. Just get up and try again. I'll never lose hope, never lose faith. There's much too much at stake. Upon myself I must depend. I'm not looking for place to show I'm gonna win. When it's all said and done, my once in a lifetime won't be back again. Now is the time to take a stand. That's why I'll never give up, never give in, never let a ray of doubt slip in. And if I fall, I'll never fail. I'll just get up and try again. Never lose hope, never lose faith. There's much too much at stake. Upon myself, I must depend. I'm not looking for a place to show I'm going.